generally it's really, truly not understood that any kind, any brand, any form of freedom is an inner, not an outer condition. The average person thinks of freedom as only related to outer conditions. But spiritual seekers require a better understanding. So no grace, no guru, no God, no anything, no anyone can give you freedom. You have to get it for yourself. The reason people fall into the notion that it can be conferred, can be given by some greater power, by some higher authority, by grace itself, is because even though you have to do it for yourself, you can't do it by yourself. You have to have some type of assistance from some source. Otherwise, it's just too difficult. There's too many blind spots. How can you see where you're not free if you're looking through your own eyes? Certain areas will simply not be visible to you. You can't see behind you. So, because of those blind spots, it's literally impossible to get to freedom, garner genuine freedom on your own. You have to have some kind of help. That's not to your discredit. The intelligent approach is to recognize that that's wise and good. But for those interested in freedom in any degree, you really, really owe it to yourself to grasp the truth of it, that it's an inner phenomena. You can only get freedom from inside you. If the inside of you is free, the outside cannot be experienced as a limitation of your freedom. Even if they put you in jail, even if they throw away the key, even in the biggest, deepest darkness, real freedom has its own light, and it comes from the inside. Now that's a high attainment. But it has to be, if freedom interests you, it has to be the goal. The goal has to be the highest form, the highest attainment, because if you set the bar lower, you'll settle for something that isn't freedom. In most things, I'm overly practical. I tell you, lower the bar. You're setting too high an ideal, and you're likely to frustrate yourself. You're likely to judge yourself as not good enough. Set a goal that you know you can reach, and then go on from there. Then you can raise it from there. But in this one, when it comes to the subject of freedom, you really have to start with the highest goal, with the bar as high as it goes. Otherwise, you'll mistake something less than true freedom for freedom. Because even a little more freedom will feel so radically different from where you start, so surprisingly fresh, so shockingly more spacious than what you're used to, that it's easy, understandable, that you would say, oh, I think I've reached real freedom. But it'll just be a little bit, because it can't be one leap. It's too big. It's too big a goal. It's too radical a change of the entire set of internal conditions, interior experience. So it's garnered more and more and more at a time, not all at once. The idea that you leap into real freedom is unrealistic. It's never been done. It's not the way it works. So generally, the average person is not interested in freedom because they think they're already free enough. So generally, it's only the spiritual seeker who says, I want freedom, or I recognize that more freedom is possible, or even I recognize that I'm not genuinely free, and it sounds like a right goal to me. Not everybody responds to that word, but it doesn't matter whether you're after God, after truth, after self-realization. It doesn't matter what your word or phrase, what aspect it captures, it always includes the element of freedom. If you get closer to God, you'll be more free. If you're more familiar with the truth itself, you'll be more free. If you're moving towards reality as it is, you're moving towards more freedom. Freedom, unlike a lot of other spiritual topics, spiritual words and phrases, what they represent. Freedom has to be garnered as much as you can, and then more. And as much more as you can, and then more. It has to be understood as a leapfrogging, never a straight line. Because you're building something inside yourself, and then you're on a better level, and then you build upward from there, and more and more. So it can't be done as a single achievement. You can't attain to freedom except in a zigzag fashion. So rather than be frustrated by that or think you're not going fast enough, you just have to understand how it works. That it'll be piece by piece, little by little, more and more, not ever one giant leap. With some things, one giant leap takes you most of the way. It can never be that way with freedom. The reasons why that's true are a long list. We don't have to go over the list. But the obvious is that you start from a highly conditioned position, highly influenced by outside influences, so you don't even know what freedom means in terms of your own view of things, your own experience. You're having a biased experience to begin with. If your parents are one type of person, you're having one kind of experience. If your parents and your family are a very different kind of set of people, you'll have a whole different kind of experience. You're already biased in a particular direction that doesn't represent your natural self. It represents where you found yourself early in life. So already you're in a position from the get-go that cannot in any way be represented as I started freely. You don't start freely. You have to do as you're told when you're little. Somebody else is in charge, not you. So that can't be a system for learning how to be free. That's a system for learning how to fit in and how to know society's rules and how to not get in trouble with other people. But it's not a system for freedom. So anyone who's in any degree interested in freedom or sees the value of more freedom has the responsibility, realizes fairly quickly that there's a lot of untraining necessary because you're starting with a not accurate definition or sense of what it means to be truly free or more free. So that's why it's a difficult road and tends to be a long road, because first you have to do the digging out before you can do the building, because the idea of freedom you start with is generally a misguided definition, a not accurate idea, mostly determined by the society you were raised in, mostly accepted before you could think for yourself. So even if, and I'm in that category, one of those people who's never particularly interested or concerned about freedom, so I get to talk about it because everything I know about it is from actual experience, not from being interested, not from reading about it, hearing about it, listening. It's from whatever I know personally. When you're not interested, you're a more reliable source of information. So freedom is part of the picture no matter what. If you're not interested, if you're like I was, and to a degree still am, not interested that much in the notion of freedom, then you at least have to accept and understand that any spiritual interest, any spiritual seeking, any trying to get anywhere spiritually is a situation of trying to garner more freedom. It's just part of it. That's the way it is. You don't have to be interested in freedom to get more free. But if you are interested in freedom, then there's things to understand about the nature of what that means. And if you're not interested in freedom, then I'll repeat it, then you at least have to understand that you are after freedom, whether you're interested or not, because it's included in any spiritual movement. If you're trying to know God for real, that has something to do with your degree of freedom. If you're trying to actually get to the truth itself, that has something to do with your ability to move in freedom. If you're trying to know who you are, that obviously has to do with getting more free. So there's no escape from the importance of this subject, but there are different types of people who either are more or are less interested in that particular subject. But the subject applies to everyone, whether you're interested or not. That's the point I'm trying to make. That if you're one of those who are not interested, just understand that it applies to you just as much. You just have a different word for it, a different sense of it, a different goal that motivates you, a different set of interests. Nevertheless, you are trying to find more freedom. You're trying to move in a freer way. So the general notion that most of us have is that freedom means we'll have more of something, maybe more of everything. That freedom is like a commodity. You probably have some kind of notion, at least like this, floating around in there, so don't reject it out of hand, what I'm saying. So we have been taught generally to think of freedom as an object, as a commodity, as desirable, but a commodity, an object in the sense that it's for us. If I have more freedom, I'll be happier. I'll have a better life. I'll do better. I'll be able to achieve things I wouldn't otherwise. It's the selfish misunderstanding, the self-based and selfish view, wrong definition of what freedom means. So notice how much that influences you, how much that's your idea that you're carrying, that freedom means more for me, and simply be smarter and understand that that's not what freedom means. More for you is just desire. It's just ego. It's not freedom in any way. So to move further toward freedom, the first step is to understand that it has nothing to do with garnering anything for yourself. Because if freedom is anything, it's not freedom for you. when you get a real dose of freedom, for sure and for real and permanently, you'll notice right away that the quality of it is, it's not freedom for you, it's freedom from you. Freedom from your limited sense of self. Freedom from your ego way of experiencing. Freedom from desires that have you going in all directions and causing all kinds of confusion. It's not freedom for you to experience. It's freedom from the you that is chasing experience, so that you actually can relax a little bit, let go a little bit, accept a little bit, so that you're not being driven by every thought and every emotion and every desire. It's not freedom for you, so that you're bigger. It's freedom from yourself, so that you're bigger. Because freedom, it turns out, I'm just going right to the end point, freedom, as it turns out, is acceptance of the universal, above and beyond and over the personal. The universal is the everything, and the personal is the constricted, limited sense that, of course, is the unfree position. So what's the biggest limitation that we all tend to live with that prevents any real, true freedom, which means spiritual freedom? That's right, you guessed it. Your ego. Your ego is your jailer. Your ego is your influence away from the decisions that free you, away from seeing what freedom actually means, away from the experience of something much, much beyond you, just you, something way, way bigger. That way bigger is what freedom means. When you are not looking at yourself this way, and you're actually having the ability to use your vision this way, to see the wholeness of things, to see the bigger picture, to see the universality in everything that's particular, everything that's small is part of something much bigger. Until you can see that for yourself, until it's crystal clear to your eyes, you'll continue to have some misguided notion that freedom is something that you get, and you get it for you. You can get an apple pie for you. You can get a car for you. You can get a Costco membership for you. But you can't get freedom for you, because when it's really that, you can if you have that false notion of freedom, but that's not freedom. I'm talking about real freedom. So when it's real freedom, it will not be for you. It will have something to do with the whole, with that which is absolutely universal. So you start from the conditioned position. So your allegiances represent, on one level, on many levels, but on that level, your allegiances and your affiliations that you're taught are just preferences and just good associations turn out to be barriers to freedom. If you feel allegiance to the country you're born and raised in, that prevents you from recognizing the universality, what's universal about all countries. You start to think your country's better, and you don't see the value of the way people live in other countries. You just assume it's not quite as good as yours. So these allegiances blind you. You start, when you're small, with a primary allegiance to your family, to the family you're raised in, no matter who the people are to you biologically, the people, the milieu you grow up in. That blinds you to what's available in other families. Your childish assumption is my family's better. Even if they're horrible, you think they're better. That's just the way children think. It's an idealization. But you can carry that into adulthood and throughout your whole life. So whatever has the adjective your in front of it, is your an adjective? What is that? Anyway, whatever has the word your in front of it, your mind tends to take as superior to someone else's. That comes from the original allegiances. My family is preferable to other families. It can't be as good there as it is here, even whether it's good or not, really. You idealize it as it's good. So if some other family lives a whole different way, oh, well, that can't be good. It blinds you. You cannot see the value beyond what you're familiar with. You mistake difference for less than. So it gives you a kind of an arrogance. It gives you the base human arrogance that most of us have. So all of this, I'm just giving you some simple examples, all of this is anti-freedom. Your allegiances bind you, limit you, and blind you. How are they in the service of freedom? They're not. So society teaches you allegiances are good. Every genuine spiritual teacher teaches you allegiances are too limiting. You need to move more and more towards the universal, toward the whole, toward that which includes everything and everyone. So you simply change your allegiance from the small to the big. You don't have to throw the allegiance out. You just universalize it. You become a citizen of the universe, not even a citizen of the world, a citizen of the universe, instead of a citizen of this country or that country. In your heart, in your mind, in the way you carry yourself. And then you're moving in a more free way. Your allegiances is one level that limits your freedom. Your desires are another level that limits your freedom. Your thought streams, thought processes are another level. It's many, many things. But generally, what you're taught is the things that give you identity are very positive. And if you look deeper, you'll see the things that give you identity from the outside are freedom reducing and freedom limiting and freedom negating. The ultimate freedom, the real freedom, is identityless. It's the universal itself. That's why it's never freedom for you, because for means you have some kind of identity. Some kind of personal identity, some kind of identification that you say, this is me, and everything that isn't this is not me. That's not freedom, that's limitation. So it's understandable why societies teach its members to pledge allegiance and to feel a sense of belonging. And to even have an arrogance that assumes our way is good, maybe even superior to other ways. But if you want freedom, you got to give that up. Because those are the ways of blind thinking and blind perceiving and blind assuming, the ways of arrogance and the ways of looking in limited fashion. Freedom means you are moving toward the universal. More toward the universal, the more you will feel freedom is happening. The more you move toward the personal, which is where we all start, 100% at the personal, the more you have put blinders around any possibility of freedom, the more you are limiting yourself and your perception. So just remember that part, if nothing else, that freedom means toward the universal, not more for me personally. That's not freedom, that's bondage.